morning. Welcome. A little light this morning. Everybody kind of getting in little by little. A little chilly out there today. I know some of y'all like this really nice cold winter weather, but I prefer to be down in the Bahamas or something like that. All right, let's start with song this morning. Let's stand and sing. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. Salvation belongs to our God, who sits upon the throne. And unto the Lamb be praise and glory, wisdom and thanks, honor and power and strength be to our God forever and ever. Be to our God forever and ever. Be to our God forever and ever. Amen. And we, the redeemed, shall be strong in purpose and in unity, declaring aloud praise and glory, wisdom and thanks, honor and power and strength be to our God forever and ever. Be to our God forever and ever. Be to our God forever and ever. Amen. Be to our God forever and ever. Be to our God forever and ever. Be to our God forever and ever. Amen. Blue skies and rainbows and sunbeams from heaven are what I can see. When my Lord is living in me, I know that Jesus is well and alive today. He makes his home in my heart. Nevermore will I be all alone, since he promised me that we never would part. Green grass and flowers are blooming in springtime, all works of the Master. I live for each day. I know that Jesus is well and alive today. He makes his home in my heart. Nevermore will I be all alone, since he promised me that we never would part. Tall mountains, green valleys, the beauty that surrounds me, all make me aware of the one who made it all. I know that Jesus is well and alive today. He makes his home in my heart. Nevermore will I be all alone, since he promised me that we never would part. Man, you may be seated, please.
Shall we pray? Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, our Creator, Sustainer, Savior, and King, you certainly deserve our praise and humble service. May the Holy Spirit teach us compassion and the joy of serving others. Lord, thank you for giving us your holy scriptures containing your identity, works, and promises for the future of your eternal kingdom. Lead us to the truth and help us to speak the truth in love. Please bless Jeff's words and help us to engrave them on our hearts with your promises. As you have been merciful, patient, and forgiving to us, may we be to others who need to hear about your Son, Jesus Christ. Believe and follow him. Lord, guide us to be careful how we live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. Lord, I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's stand and sing this next song. You can't sing a song sitting down when it starts with "I stand to pray." I stand to praise you, but I fall on my knees. My spirit is willing, but my flesh is too weak. Like a fire in my soul, can the flame make me whole? Lord, you know
Danny, we always stand, but we never fall to our knees in the second part of that. You ever wonder about that? Mostly because, you know, half of our knees have been replaced for a lot of us, and we're so. No, I'm kidding. It's a great song. I am in, I think now day 30 of the 100-day cough, so hopefully this won't intrude too much in today. But it's good to be here. Welcome. It's good to see everybody. If you're joining us online, depending on your neighborhood, you might be smart joining us online. My sister in Knoxville, they had 8 inches of snow on Sunday. Their neighborhood has not been plowed out. They haven't had trash removal or mail delivery, and they just got a notice that all the ATMs were out because the cash replenishment trucks couldn't get to the ATMs. So, hey, Knoxville, not used to snow, but we're doing pretty well here. Glad you could make it this morning. If you're a guest, we're really glad that you're here. And we would love to know something about you. The QR code on the seat back in front of you is the easiest way to do that. It takes you to our connection code. I should also remind you that, again, the sermon presentation is out there. And I tell you that because this morning we're going to be moving kind of quick. So if you miss some things that you it just goes by too quick and you wanted to see that slide and you didn't get to read it, you can go back and find it that way if you would like. I should also tell you, you might have noticed the great side screen experiment of 2023-2024 has ended. We have decided that the light that we gain from having that middle screen up doesn't really do that much. So thank you for your input. We're back to the normal screen distribution, and I don't plan on saying anything else about it. Ryan, is that all right? Okay. So we are in a sermon series that has the overall purpose, I think, of reaffirming and reinforcing the central aspects of the Christian faith. That's what we're talking about for the next several weeks. We're talking about the core teachings. We're talking about the non-negotiables. We're titling it the essentials because that's really what we're talking about, the things that are essential to our faith. Eight foundational truths, eight pillars on which all of Christianity rests. Take anyone out, you don't have Christianity. It just doesn't work that way. And so these are core. Last week, we spent some time looking at evidence that supports the fact that Jesus was a person, a human being. Not only that, a historical figure, not just some made-up character that appears in a storybook. Jesus was a real person. And we looked extensively at evidence that exists outside the Bible. A number of historians who were not Christians, who were in fact in some ways antagonistic to Christianity, but whose writings support what was in the Bible, that was very important. We spent a little extra time talking about the significance of the historical evidence that supports the fact that Jesus was raised from the dead. Because believe it or not, there's evidence that supports that, that doesn't depend on your view of the Bible. And so that was significant as well, and I think this helps to establish that Jesus was not just a real person, but that the Bible is reliable. And that really is incredibly important. The Bible is reliable. The Bible is a credible source for information about Jesus. And that, I think, was a necessary step because, you know, a lot of people have questions about the Bible. A lot of people have doubts about the accuracy of the Bible, the authenticity of the Bible. This is a thing. And so what I want us to do today is to take a step deeper into that subject because, as it turns out, the Scriptures, the Word of God, the Bible, is one of the essential pillars of Christianity. What the Bible is and what it means, what it is not, this is part of the foundation on which Christianity rests. We believe as Christians that the Bible is a book, but it's not only a book. Right? We have convictions about that. There are a lot of books that have been written, a lot of great books. Maybe you have some favorite books. The Bible is a book, but it is not only a book. We believe that, in fact, it comes from God, that by design, God gives it to us exactly as he wants us to have it. He gives us everything we need in his Scriptures. But that is a lot to swallow whole, especially if you are struggling with the accuracy or the authenticity of the Scriptures. That's a lot to accept just outright. And so what I want to do this morning is I want to break this down a little bit, I hope in a way that it's effective. Now, again, we're going to move fast today. There are libraries dedicated to this subject, the whole area of apologetics. It can get very technical and very dry very quickly. I have aspired to avoid that. I don't know whether it will succeed or not, but that's the attempt. We can only do so much in one sermon and one follow-up class, so that is part of this as well. But one of the things that I hope will happen in this series as we talk quickly about these incredibly important topics is I hope that you will be motivated to search more. I hope that you'll be motivated to go deeper. I hope you'll be motivated to ask questions. Because again, you know, this is not stuff that's personal matters of opinion, right? This is not stuff that's kind of important. This is stuff that is essential. It is essential to what we believe as Christians. It is essential to who we are as Christians. And so it is that important. So after taking some time to establish the reliability of the Bible from outside sources, Now we need to move inside. And so in effect, in other words, what does the Bible tell us about itself? And so you may think we have jumped too far for that. Again, there's other conversations we can have, other resources we can look at, but we need to move to this next thing to keep this going and to keep it within a reasonable time frame. And so we now need to move inside the Bible itself today. We need to think about what the Bible tells us about where it comes from and what its purpose is and how it's given to us. And so let's start with something here this morning that everybody, I think, should know, but probably an awful lot of us have not given a lot of thought to, or at least not as much as we should. And that is this: the Bible that we read about in the New Testament is almost always the Old Testament. That's an important point for us as Christians, because we have ideas about the Old Testament, and some of them are not really grounded in Scripture. And so one of the things we need to understand is when you see scriptural references coming up in the New Testament, almost in every case, they're referring to Old Testament text. That's incredibly important. Now, maybe, you know, again, I don't want to assume any level of understanding here, so I want to throw some basic stuff out here. If you already know this, that's great. If you don't, that's great. I want us to all kind of come along in tandem if we can. And so if you're new to these terms, the Old Testament is the first 39 books in your Bible. If you got an old paper copy, you know, two-thirds of the weight of the thickness of your Bible is these 39 books that we think of as the Old Testament. This is Genesis through Malachi. This is the Hebrew Bible. And these are the scriptures that God gives first to God's first kingdom people, right, which is the Jews. And so this is the Old Testament. Now, Jesus, in his comments that we have recorded for us in the Gospels, Jesus quotes from at least 14 different Old Testament books. Jesus, again, when he's referencing Scripture, he's referencing the Old Testament. More than any other book, he references the book of Psalms. Believe it or not, the book that he references the second most is Deuteronomy. Boy, that's a book we struggle to read sometimes. Jesus quotes from it all the time. Incredibly significant book in Jesus' speech and in his teaching. And so he does it in different ways, but one example, one way that you can kind of see that maybe Jesus is referring to the Old Testament is the many times where he starts out a statement, he says something like, "It is written." And then he says something after that. When he's talking about "it is written," he's saying, "I'm about to quote the Old Testament." And so that's what Jesus does. Jesus believed in the inspiration and the authority of the Hebrew Bible. And as did, not surprisingly, as did the apostles that he taught and discipled, as did the other writers of the New Testament letters and texts that were not apostles. There's a couple of them. They all believed in the inspiration and the authority of the Hebrew Bible. But not only that, and this is incredibly significant as well, Jesus himself saw himself as, in fact, the point of the Old Testament, the fulfillment of the Old Testament. As he says here in Luke chapter 24, verse 27, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures about him. So he's going back to the whole Old Testament, and he's saying, "Let me show you how the Old Testament points to me." If that is not an indication of how significant and important the Old Testament is, I don't know what is. And so it's no surprise then that after Jesus, after the Messiah comes along, his life and his teachings become the basis for the New Testament. So the New Testament now is these next books that you find the thinner section in your old paper Bibles, if you got them, 27 books, Matthew through Revelation. The New Testament tells the story, of course, of Jesus. It's the story of his life and his teachings, his death, his burial, and his resurrection. But it is not only that. It then becomes the story of what he leaves behind, the legacy of the apostles going out into the world and making disciples, and how that becomes the church, and what the church is for, what the church is about, and how the church should work. And so there are those books. Excuse me. There are books that tell us how God wants us as his people to act individually, and how he wants us to act in community, collectively as the church, as he wants us to go out into the world and to live in the world as his disciples. And so all this is found in the New Testament. The books of the New Testament come to us primarily through the apostles. And we get a glimpse of how this is going to work just in general in this text in John's gospel. And so what this tells us essentially is that the Holy Spirit is going to remind the apostles of the things that Jesus had done, of the things that Jesus had said. And not only that, he's going to help them to understand what it means, and he's going to help them to understand why it matters. He is going to do this. This passage in John 14 is not given to every one of us. It's given to the apostles, because the apostles are going to have this primary responsibility. And then eventually they're going to take this information that they get through God, from God, through the Holy Spirit. They're going to take this stuff and they're going to start to write it down. And in fact, this is an early description of what we come to know or think of as the inspiration of the Bible. Again, a whole large topic. We can come at this from some different angles to get our hands around what this means. But in essence, this book, or this verse, describes how it works. And basically the fact that the book, the Bible, is written by humans, but its content comes from God. Humans are going to write it down, but the message they're going to write down and preserve for us is going to be a message that God preserves by his Holy Spirit to make sure it is what God wants us to have. And so that's how inspiration works. And so then we keep moving on. We've got a lot of ground to cover. As I've already alluded, the Bible as we know it today combines the old and the new into one. One great big book, right? If you got an old paper Bible handy, it's a big book. Real thin paper to make it so that it's not as big as it would be if it was the same kind of paper that, you know, the novels you read, right? It's a big book with a lot of stuff in it. And the thing is, every bit of it matters. All of it, from beginning to end, from Genesis through Revelation, it all matters. It all has authority because it's all the Word of God. It is all God speaking. It is all significant. You know, when you go back and you read in this famous passage in 2 Timothy chapter 3, all Scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the servant of God, the person of God, may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. When you read that, when it refers to all Scripture as being God-breathed, it's talking about both the Old Testament and the New Testament. We need both the Old Testament and the New Testament. We should study, we should know, we should endeavor in our best effort to understand both the Old Testament and the New Testament. There is so much that we can't begin to comprehend if we do what so many Christians unfortunately have done for many centuries, and including right up until present time, and which is to neglect the Old Testament. So many of us have neglected the Old Testament. So many of our churches have neglected the Old Testament. We will certainly start to see what a mistake this will be next week when we start to look into a discussion for a couple of weeks about the nature of God. These are pillars of Christianity. And you know what? A lot of what we know about God and who he is and what he reveals and his character and his nature, we're going to get from the Old Testament. And so we need all of it. It all comes from God. It all matters. Having said that, even though the Old Testament has great value, even though it has incredible importance, even though it has authority, for Christians, the New Testament has greater authority than the Old Testament. The New Testament tells us about God's new covenant. And there's a lot we could talk about, but a couple things of particular significance. Under this new covenant that comes when Jesus comes, the old covenant with all of its laws, the sacrificial system with all of its rituals, it's been done away with once and for all. It's been rendered ineffective or obsolete by the sacrifice of Jesus on the cross and his resurrection from the dead. Now, the law in particular is still relevant. It's going to be restated in many ways in the New Testament. It's going to be revived and reinforced. But we don't go back and look to the Old Testament for how to do things, what rules to follow. We don't look to the Old Testament for our instructions about worship and things like that anymore. We go to the New Testament because Jesus has made the old covenant obsolete. That's not all. Through Christ, salvation does not depend on your ethnicity. In the old covenant, in a sense, it did. You could become a part of God's first kingdom people, but essentially what you had to do there was you had to become a Jew. You had to become part of the Jewish faith, which was more commonly you were born into it. That is no longer the way that it works. It's not going to be your ethnicity, I have a hard time saying that word, ethnicity that determines your presence among God's kingdom people. It's going to be a decision that you make. And so we now interpret the Old Testament in light of the things that have happened in the New. This was something that God's kingdom people could not do before the Messiah. It's something that they really couldn't do until after the Messiah had gone and they started to look at all of these things and understand them differently. But this is what we do now. We interpret the Old Testament in light of what has happened in the New, and in particular, in light of the life and teachings of Jesus. Jesus is going to be the key to us understanding all Scripture. Hebrews 1 puts it this way: in the past, God spoke to our ancestors through the prophets, and many times and in various ways. You can go read the prophets. There's 17 books of prophecy in the Old Testament. But in these last days, the time we're in now, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things and through whom he has also made the universe. And so Jesus makes sense of the Old Testament, helps us to put it in the proper place, understand it as one continuous story, even though the New Testament is our primary area of authority and emphasis. By the way, one of the things you need to understand, again, I don't know if you're thinking now, well, wait, how many covenants have there been? How many more are there going to be? One of the things you can hang your hat on is there not going to be any more new covenants. There are not going to be any more New Testaments coming along. We are done with that. The Scriptures, the Bible, as we have been given, it is complete now. And in fact, it was complete in the sense that the last book had been actually written, put down to paper before the end of the first century AD. So, you know, coming up on essentially 2,000 years ago, every word that God intended to be in the Bible had already been written by that sense, by the end of the first century. Now, this is an area, if you've done any reading or studying, or if you've just spent any time sort of contemplating how all this works, this is an area in which people have a lot of questions. And I get that. There's a lot of information floating out there. One of the great challenges of the modern age in every aspect of life, whether you're trying to make decisions about your health or about politics or whatever, is there's so much information. What is good information versus what's garbage, right? And it's really hard to know because we're overwhelmed by information. And so you just don't always know where to go to find the good stuff. And I got to be honest, there's a lot of garbage out there that has to do with the Bible that I think essentially is created and intended to create doubt in you, to get you to say, well, I'm not so sure that the Bible is what they've always been telling me the Bible is. And so if the Bible is not this holy book that comes directly from God, then what's the point? And so a lot of information is designed, I think, to accomplish that. You can't hardly turn on the History Channel or the Discovery Channel without some expert claiming that, for example, hey, you should know that the Bible that you've been reading, it's not all there. Like, there's all these other books, there's these other gospels that you need to know. They say other stuff, but they've been kept from you. They've been hidden from you. The people who wrote those books lost the battle in history to get their stuff included. And so what you have is fine, but it's not complete. There's all kinds of stuff like that. It is garbage. It is bunk. But you should know, as you study this, it took a while for everyone to accept what belonged in the Bible and what didn't belong in the Bible. God didn't say, as we sometimes wish he would have, you know, Jesus dies, he's raised from the dead. Acts chapter 1, here are all the books that have been written and all the books that will be written. These are the only ones that count. These are the only ones you should read. He doesn't do it that way. Again, he's using human beings, he's using time. And so, you know, it took a while. The core books in the New Testament were accepted by the middle of the second century. Everybody pretty much said, yes, these are in. But the final list of books that includes all the books of the New Testament that we know doesn't show up until the 367 AD. So another 200 years after that before the list is kind of finalized. And so this is interesting. So in his book, there's a million books. I think I have 8 or 10 books on this in some area in my library. I haven't even read them all. There's millions of books on this stuff. I was dabbling in a book by Jonathan Morrow, Questioning the Bible, 11 Major Challenges to the Bible's Authenticity. It's one book you could look at. The good ones will all essentially say something very similar. And he describes here how, you know, the 27 books that we think of as the New Testament, that is the New Testament, these books are included in the New Testament primarily because they fit with the authoritative teaching of the apostles. Remember that passage from John 14? Jesus says, look, I'm going to go away, but the Holy Spirit's going to come and he's going to tell you what you need to know, and you're going to make sure this gets distributed. And so it's apostolic authority that is the primary driver because they can trace that back to Jesus himself. And so, again, this is the primary standard as to whether something should belong in the Bible or not, in the New Testament or not. And so he talks about there being four basic kinds of books in this conversation. And so first you have the books that were from a very early time recognized as, yeah, these are clearly from God. These are clearly inspired. These clearly belong in the core. And so the Gospels and Acts and some of Paul's writings and things like that, which for the most part are recognized right away. Hebrews has some issues because it doesn't claim a specific author Revelation has some questions because it's odd. But for the most part, from very early on, these books were recognized. Along with that, there were some books that were disputed. So basically, these were books that, you know, as they were read, these letters, people said, well, the stuff that's in here seems to be orthodox. It seems to be in line with Christian teaching, with the apostolic teaching. But there's just enough weirdness in here that we're not sure. So we're going to have to debate these for a little bit. And so they debated those. It took a little longer for those. And we get that if you've ever read the book of James, right? It's kind of weird. It's just different. James is a different dude coming from a different perspective. And so you can understand why they might go, oh, let's talk about James for a little while before we decide whether this really lines up with the teaching of the apostles. And then there were the books that were pretty good, but ended up being rejected because for one reason or another, they weren't quite, I don't know, they were useful, but they weren't orthodox. Or there's some good stuff in there, but there's enough questions that we would not say that they came from the apostolic teaching. And a way to think about this, he makes the point, I think it's a good one. Think of how sometimes, you hear a preacher reference somebody like C.S. Lewis, who might say, look, there's this really great book C.S. Lewis wrote, it's called The Screwtape Letters. If you want to understand spiritual warfare, you should go read this book. It's not scripture. It's not inspired by God. It's just a smart guy who looks at things from a different perspective, and it might help you understand scripture. It's not the same, it's not equal to scripture, but it's useful, it's good. So it's okay, it just doesn't belong in the Bible. And then you have the heretical books. And some of these were just forgeries, you know, they were just trying to claim credit for people that didn't write them. A lot of them contained teaching that was, to say the least, unorthodox. And in most cases, they contain teachings and things that just conflicted with the core, things that stood in direct conflict with the truths that we know from the books that were not disputed. And so these books were not to be read. They were not to be used in the church. They were to be avoided by the early Christians. They were seen as dangerous. And so you should know, when you go out on YouTube and you do some kind of a search for, you know, the New Testament canon, or why do books end up in the New Testament, and you get some talking head, and he brings up some book that you never heard of before, like the Gospel of Peter or the Gospel of Thomas, and he says, this book should be in the Bible, he's probably talking about one of these heretical books that Christianity discounted almost 2,000 years ago. Because they knew then what we should know now. These books are not inspired. These books do not belong in the Holy Scriptures. Because again, this was clearly and finally established 1,700 years ago. This has just not been in question by any serious student of how this works. We've known this for a long time. And so among other things, one of the other things you can say about this is later claims to add things to the Bible that come from other sources that can't be accepted. They lie outside of scripture. So if you're a part of a group, if you're looking for a church and you come on a group and the group says, hey, we got the Bible and it's good, but we also have this other book and it's just as good, or maybe even a little better. You need this book to understand the Bible. Run. Because they have added something that is not from the inspired word of God. If you're looking for a church and you come upon a group that has all these other traditions that are super important, they become part of the doctrine of that church, and you say, well, where did this come from? And they don't take you to the scriptures to say this is where it comes from. They take you to these other books, these books of tradition, these books of interpretation. They say, well, this is why we do this, and why this now is how we do it instead of what's in the Bible. Run. These are not places where we should be learning how to live and how to follow God, because they are not truth. They are not scripture. Now, I'm throwing a lot of stuff at you this morning, and there's more. There are other things about the text of the Bible that, frankly, raise questions. It's okay to ask questions. There are some textual variants that you will come across. This is probably the best known, Mark chapter 16. One of the great things about the newer translations of scripture is they almost always will set these off, and they will clearly mark them. And they will say things like, you know, the best early manuscripts we have don't have this passage, but some of the later ones do. So here it is. You decide what to do with it. But that can cause some questions, right? And you go and you read and you find out, well, there's some copying errors and things like that that have appeared in the Bible that people will say, well, there's all these mistakes in the scripture. And so even though we can identify them easily because we have so many, that can shake your faith. And there are challenges that come when we translate from one language into another, because no two languages can perfectly move from one into the other. And so this can be an issue. It is okay to ask questions about the Word of God or any other aspect of faith. It is okay if you're wrestling with some doubts. You know, you hear some information and you're just not sure how to deal with it. It's okay. It's reasonable as you work through these things. We don't have time to even attempt to work through all of those today. Feel free to bring them up in class next week. Larry Good is going to be teaching. He doesn't have all the answers, but Larry is a super thorough, knowledgeable guy. He will be able to at least tell you, well, here's places you can go look to get some answers. So bring those to class. But again, questions, doubts, they are fine. As long as you pursue answers, and as long as the answers you pursue are from reliable sources, there's good places to go for answers, there's stupid places to go for answers. And so that's significant, but you can be confident, you can be confident that the Bible we have is the Bible God wanted us to have. You can put your faith in that. You can hang your hat on that. You can be confident that what was written in the first century by those apostles and those early people, early followers of Jesus who had interacted with Jesus and seen Jesus and talked to Jesus, you can know that the stuff that was written in the first century is the stuff that you're reading today. Even though it's written now in a different language, you can be confident in that. Very quickly, because if this hasn't been dry enough for you this morning, we're about to like wring all the moisture that's left out of it. But I think it's worth mentioning here. Here are some reasons that we can be confident that the word that God gave us is in fact the word that we have. For starters, we don't have, you should know this, we don't have any original documents. We don't have any of it. We don't have originals of any ancient document. They don't exist. They were written on stuff that deteriorated. It went away. And so what we have are copies. And so when you want to, an archaeologist, that's not the word, the people who study this, when they try to figure out whether a copy is reliable or not, one of the things they want to know is, well, how many copies do we have? Because if you have a bunch of copies, then you can compare them with each other and you can see where the mistakes are, where the errors are, where the questions are. And so you should know that we have more manuscript copies of the New Testament than there exists of any other ancient book, including some books that nobody ever questions, right? If you have a copy of the first history that was ever written, the Peloponnesian War by Thucydides, there's only a couple of copies of that. And yet we have thousands of copies of the New Testament. If you've ever read the Iliad, that's pretty good. But still, nothing compared to what we have in the New Testament. So the accuracy of the New Testament text is unparalleled because we can compare it to other copies. Not only that, but this is the other important thing that they look for. When you compare, especially to other ancient books, there's a much shorter time span between when the originals would have been written and when we have our first copy. In the case of the New Testament, we have copies that are appearing as little as 35 years from after the original would have been written down. And you can see the dates for some of these others. In some cases, it's over 1,000 years between when it originally was recorded and when we have our first copy. This is important. This is important because when human beings have a lot of time to take something and to make copies, they also have a lot of time to mess with it. They also have a lot of time to add commentary or to make adjustments or to add corrections. Oh, this isn't really clear. Maybe I should put an extra sentence or an extra paragraph in here. So the less time you have, the more accurate it's likely to be because human beings don't have as much chance to do what they do to mess with the text. And so this is another testimony. And along with that, those early and plentiful copies, we have the writings of the men who come to be known as the Church Fathers. And these wrote very early, between 90 and 160 AD. In fact, the earliest, probably Polycarp, probably starts to write while John is still alive. And so these guys were around and they were old and they quote a whole bunch of New Testament scripture, even though some of the books were still being debated at the time, and they confirm the primary doctrine of the New Testament. So we take all those things together. Now, that is a lot of stuff I just threw at you. Here's why it matters. Maybe not all of why it matters, but here's some of why it matters. I was reading recently about, this is a picture of, in fact, something that's called the Codex Sassoon. The Codex Sassoon is the oldest, nearly complete copy of the Hebrew Bible that we have. All right? It's about 1,100 years old. It has something on the order of 750 pages of, you know, the pages, the reason why it's so well preserved is they were printed on animal skins. Sorry if that offends your, you know, from a take care of the animals perspective. I'm just reporting what they did. As you can imagine, that Bible weighs a lot. It's about 26 pounds. I don't know if that's something you would want to like put under your arm and carry to church to read out of, but you know, 1,100 years ago, if you even just had a copy like that, you were a fabulously wealthy person because the printing press hadn't been developed yet. Somebody did that by hand. The Codex Sassoon sold last year at auction $38 million. $38 million. I hope you know that the Word of God is worth way more than $38 million. I mean, it is. I mean, yeah, that's an artifact. It's a historical thing. I get why somebody would pay that. But the Word of God is worth a whole lot more. I got to tell you, if eternal life is of interest to you, and I hope it's of interest to you, you should know that this is where you're going to be guided to eternal life and what you need to do to receive eternal life. And there's nowhere else. There's nowhere else. Because, you know, there are a lot of ideas out there about the afterlife, but no other source that is trying to tell you what the afterlife is like, no other source is God-breathed. You want to know about eternal life? You need to go to the Word of God to learn about eternal life. Because it is God-breathed, it's inspired by God, that means that the Bible has authority in our lives. This matters. This matters a great deal. You know, we don't worship the book. Over the years, sometimes conservative churches that put a lot of stock in Scripture as the Word of God, sometimes we've been accused of worshiping the Bible. We don't worship the Bible, but the book is where we learn about the things that matter to God. The book is where we learn about the things that God tells us, this is how I want you to live. The book is incredibly important. And it has, if it is what it is, it has authority in our lives. I was reading an anecdote about Mark Twain. Excuse me, there's a story about at one point Mark Twain is in Boston. He runs into a local businessman there in Boston, and they get to talking. And this businessman, Twain even knows as a visitor, he knows this guy has a reputation for being kind of unscrupulous. He's dishonest. He made his fortune basically by doing anything to make a buck, no matter who it hurts. And as they're talking, he says to Twain, essentially, he describes his bucket list to Mark Twain. That term doesn't exist when this is taking place. But basically, he tells Mark Twain, I have this dream. Before I die, I want to make a pilgrimage. I want to go to the Holy Land, and I want to climb to the top of Mount Sinai. When I get up on the top of Mount Sinai, as I am surveying all of Jerusalem, I want to look down, and I want to read out loud the Ten Commandments. This is my dream. And Twain reportedly says to him, I have a better idea. Why don't you stay home in Boston and keep the commandments? The hardest part for a lot of people as they try to decide what they believe or don't believe about the Bible is not really going to come down to variations in the text. It's not really going to come down to, you know, oh, we don't have enough original copies. It's not really going to come down to, oh, well, you know, some of those books were disputed. Maybe some other books belong in there. The hardest part for many of us is that if the Bible is what Christians believe the Bible is, you got to do something about it. You can't just be neutral. If the Bible is the Word of God, and if it has God speaking to us, we better be listening, because God, being God, has authority, and so God's Word has authority. And that's one of the big reasons why this conversation matters. One more thing, lastly this morning. If you want to know God personally, if you want to have a real relationship with him, not just a touchy-feely kind of, oh, I feel God, not that feelings don't matter, but if you want to have something grounded in reality, grounded in truth, you cannot do that. You cannot have a relationship with God without the Bible. You cannot know God. Anything worth knowing about God apart from Scripture. And in fact, we're going to see that, I hope, more clearly next week as we start to think seriously about some of the most significant aspects of God's nature, God's character, beginning with the fact that the Bible describes God as holy. And that's incredibly significant. Once again, we're going to discuss the things that we talk about today in next week's Essentials class. Larry Good will be in here teaching the stuff we talked about last week. It's going to be in today's Essentials class in the auditorium. Paul Florio is going to be teaching. Let's stand. Let's sing.
Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you walking daily by the Savior's side? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Do you rest each moment in the crucified? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Lay aside the garments that are stained with sin and be washed in the blood of the Lamb. There's a fountain flowing for the soul unclean. Oh, be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? We gather here in Jesus' name. His love is burning in our hearts like living flame. For through the loving Son, the Father makes us one. Come take the bread, come drink the wine, come share the Lord. No one is a stranger here. Everyone belongs. Finding our forgiveness here, we in turn forgive all wrongs. He joins us here. He breaks the bread. The Lord who pours the cup is risen from the dead. The one we love the most is now our gracious host. Come take the bread, come drink the wine, come share the Lord. We are now a family, of which the Lord is head. The one seen, He meets us here in the breaking of the bread. We'll gather soon where angels sing. We'll see the glory of our Lord and coming King. Now we anticipate the feast for which we wait. Come take the bread, come drink the wine, come share the Lord. May you see the vision.
Good morning, family. Ada responded to the altar call. Up here in the zone. No one ever sits here. This is cool. Jesus said for us to do this each Lord's Day in remembrance of me. And I hope that that is something that we spend a fair amount of time doing, not just on Sunday mornings, but Monday through Saturday as well. When you think of Jesus, what comes to your mind? In 1 John 1:1, John says, "That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked at and our hands have touched, this we proclaim concerning the word of life." We don't have that eyewitness perspective. It's impossible for us to know Jesus physically with our five senses because we have zero to go on regarding his appearance. In Hebrews 1:1, it says, "In the past, God spoke to our ancestors through the prophets at many times and in various ways. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed an heir of all things, through whom he also made the universe." And so we can hear Jesus as he speaks through the word, but there is no voice. Romans 1:20 says, "For since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that people are without excuse." And so we can see him through all creation in the universe around us, which, as Ryan pointed out last week, the further into the universe we can look, the more evidence of his fingerprints we see. I see Jesus in images created in my mind as I read his stories in the Gospels. His appearance is not clearly defined, but he's more of the presence throughout. He comes into the world as the Jesus we're most familiar with through Mary. He shows up a few times in bodily form in the Old Testament as well. But as I read these stories over and over, I get a clearer image of who he is. So when I think of Jesus, it's more of the who and the what of his being and all that that implies in my life, and not so much how he may have appeared, that comes to mind. And that's obviously been slanted by artist renditions over the years. I imagine when the day finally comes that we do meet him face to face, it's going to be like hearing the voice of a radio broadcaster, but you don't know what they look like. And then when you finally do see a picture of them, you think, that's not at all what I thought you were going to be like. That's how I envision it. And I think it's easy to think of Jesus, you know, in the past from stories in Scripture, because we have the Bible. It's fun to try and imagine what it's going to be like in the future when, you know, as he told the criminal on the cross, "Today you'll be with me in paradise," and we imagine what that might be like. Maybe when the trumpet sounds and time will be no more. What I want to try and encourage us to do this morning is to think on and spend more time contemplating the reality of him as he is now in the church, which means dwelling in you through the Holy Spirit as his temple. So Jesus, the human being, has left this world physically, but spiritually he still lives on inside you, inside each member of the church. So, I mean, where's Jesus? There's Jesus. There's Jesus. Here's Jesus. He dwells in us. We're now the Holy of Holies, if you will, where God dwells. Hebrews 12, 1-3 says, "Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. Let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart." So week to week, what does that look like? What does fixing our eyes on Jesus look like? Luke 14, 26-27 says, "If anyone comes to me and does not hate father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, even their own life, such a person cannot be my disciple. And whoever does not carry their cross and follow me cannot be my disciple." So gut reaction to that reading is hate is a harsh word. It's even more supercharged in our culture today in some context. Scripturally, it means to love less. If you read Matthew's account, he frames it this way when he says, "Whoever loves, fill in the blank, more than me is not worthy of being mine." What Jesus is calling us to do is have such a devotion to him that our attachment to everyone and everything else seems like hate in comparison, and even our own lives. That's the call to carry your own cross. The cross obviously was an instrument of death. So that's not easy because the flesh does not want to die. It will rage, kick, and scream to have its own way. Your old self, crucified through baptism, does not want to walk in a new life. But remember Jesus' prayer in the garden, "Not my will, but thine." He fought the flesh as well, and his flesh wanted to live. He endured the cross for the joy set before him, and we are called daily on our own and together each Lord's Day to endure our own cross for the joy he set before us in this life and the life to come, so that we will not grow weary and lose heart. I'll leave you with Galatians 2:20. I've been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. In the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we just come to you this morning and thank you for Jesus. We thank you for the love and grace that you have shown from the garden, or whenever it is you put in place the plan to redeem us, that we can be part of that now as we sit here in this year in 2024 in Conestoga Valley. And we know later today there's going to be two more added to the family, and that's super exciting. Lord, we just thank you that we can be part of your plan. And we just ask for your strength as we focus this morning on Christ and remember him, to crucify ourselves daily and take deeper into our hearts and our lives what that means, to sacrifice our wants and desires to live for him and not for ourselves. He bought us, he owns us, he paid the price for us, and he's called us to walk faithfully with him. Each one of us are in different places, Father. Help us to convict ourselves wherever we're at. Recognize the things that we need to crucify in ourselves and crucify those things. Repent and move on in a closer walk with you. Thank you, Lord, so much for your love and grace that you've shown us, each one. We praise you and thank you, and we pray in Christ's name. Amen.
Stand and sing. Unto thee, O Lord, do I lift up my soul. Unto thee, O Lord, do I lift up my soul. Oh my God, I trust in thee. Let me not be ashamed, let not my enemies triumph over me. Yet let none that wait on thee be ashamed. Yet let none that wait on thee be ashamed. Oh my God, I trust in thee. Let me not be ashamed. Now my enemies triumph over me. Remember now the sins of my youth. Remember now the sins of my youth. Oh my God, I trust in thee. Let me not be ashamed, let not my enemies triumph over me. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. No more crying there, we are going to see the King. No more crying there, we are going to see the King. No more crying there, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. No more dying there, we are going to see the King. No more dying there, we are are going to see the King. No more dying there. We are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We're going to see the King.
Man, you may be seated, please.
Good morning. It's been great to see you all this morning and great to worship with you, especially if you've been visiting with us today. We've been glad to have you with us. Hope that you can come back and join us every opportunity you have. I'd like to direct you to the bulletins. There's paper copies on the way out as you leave the auditorium if you didn't grab one on your way in, or it's also delivered by email on Fridays. If you're not receiving those emails and would like to get on our list, please let one of us with a name tag know, or you can see Sarah, or give her a call or an email in the office and get on that list and stay up to date on what's going on. There's a lot of events in the bulletin for things that are coming up. Please see that calendar and don't miss something that you would like to look back on, wish you'd been a part of. I'll highlight one in particular. Next Sunday night, January 28th, we're having a game night here at the church building. Starts at 5 o'clock, goes till 7 or till whenever we decide we're done and want to close up shop. Drinks are going to be provided, I understand, but please bring a snack or a side, something to share, and RSVP if you wouldn't mind. There's a link in the sign-up link. You can do that with the QR code or see it on the church website. Let us know about how many are coming, just so we have enough drinks for everybody. Prayer list is also on the back page of the bulletin. Please make note of these folks who need our prayers. In particular, please keep Kay Moore in your prayers. I talked with Carol this morning. Kay's been home now for, I think, about a week and a half after her surgery. And recovery's just going slow. There seems to just be setbacks going on. Please keep her in your prayers. She's in a lot of pain and then just a lot of stuff going on around this. Carol? Okay. Yeah, Kay's dealing with an infection kind of after the fact from the surgery, and it's gotten bad enough. If you didn't hear what Carol said, she is going to go back to the hospital for treatment for that. So especially keep her in your prayers this week. And also the Weinbergers, as they are in the Philippines, they're coming back first week of February, so a couple more weeks of their trip to go yet. The 8th of February is when they return, so keep them in their prayers for their work there and their travel coming back. So. Let's go to God in prayer now. Father, we thank you so much for the day that you have blessed us with. We thank you for the beauty of your creation. It's been so beautiful to see the snow, even though it makes travel difficult. But it forces us to slow down a little bit. And so we're grateful for moments like this where we can reflect on just how wonderful you are. And we're grateful for the opportunity to worship you and bring you our praises this morning. And I pray that they have come from the bottom of our hearts and that you have been glorified by what we've done here this morning. And Father, we lift up our sister Kay to you now as she goes back in the hospital today for dealing with this infection and the complications around her recent surgery. We just pray you be with her doctors, that they can find the right treatment quickly for this and help her body get back to healing like it should. And just pray that you be with her. Give her strength and comfort as she deals with this, and also for Weldon and Brenda as they continue their visit with their family and doing work for your kingdom in the Philippines, and as they come back to be home over the next couple weeks, we pray that you be with them, give them safe travels. We pray you be with our Bible teachers over the next hour as they bring your word to us, as we just try to set our minds on you and take your word into our hearts, as Psalm 119 says, to let it dwell in our hearts so that we might not sin against you, but also, Father, that your word is a light to our paths and guides every step that we take in our lives. Dismiss us in your care, Father. Bless us, guide us, and may you always help us to remember your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, in everything that we do, and it's in his name that we pray. Amen.